spend some time with kids that are super cute and fun. So if you are interested in that, Jen Russell, or you can talk to John, or me, like somebody with kids with your shirt on, and we'll get you in the right place. And if you're new here, or if you change your address, we'd like to be able to get in contact with you. If you're new, John would like to like sit down, take out your coffee or something. So we have connection cards on the back table, and you can fill them out and put them in the giving box, and we'll get back with you. If you have prayer requests and things, those can also go on these cards. You can just, if we know your name, scribble your name in the front so we know who we're going for. Because we'd love to pray with you and walk beside you in that way. So, thank you for being here, and we're going to get to some more songs.
I invite you to stand again, and we're going to sing God of Miracles. And if we open our eyes, there are miracles happening around us on a daily basis. Just open your eyes. They're there.
Thank you. Good morning. If you have your Bible, 11. Aren't you blessed with worship?
Yes.
A lot of things that we appreciate about Jesus. A lot of things we know about Jesus. He is, well, he's the great I am. He's holy. He's good, he's patient, he's forgiving, he's kind, he's loving. We got this long list of things that we could say about who Jesus is to us. Today I want to look at a part of him, a story that's tells us a little bit about him that's kind of surprising, because he acts so angry in this passage. It's kind of uncharacteristic of Jesus to act this angry about it. But the problem is he was around people who were in a setting of the things of God, and they didn't cherish him.
This is the last week, by the way. Jesus has gone into Jerusalem riding on a donkey. People are saying, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. It's like his first act as king. And right away, it says he entered Jerusalem, Mark 11:11, and went into the temple. And when he looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. And on the following day, when they came from Bethany, he was hungry. And seeing in the distance a fig tree and leaf, he went to see if he could find anything on it. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. And he said to it, may no one ever eat fruit from you again. And the disciples heard it. And when they came to Jerusalem, he entered the temple again. This is the second time. And he began to drive out those who sold and those who bought in the temple. And he overturned the tables of money changers and the seats of those who sold pigeons. And he wouldn't allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. And he was teaching them and saying to them, is it not written, my house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations? But you have made it into a den of robbers. And the chief priests and the scribes heard it, the people who worked there at the temple, and were seeking a way to destroy him, because he was threatening their livelihood. For they feared him, because all the crowd was astonished at his teaching. There was nothing they could do. And when evening came, they went out of the city. And as they passed by in the morning, they saw that fig tree withered away to its roots. And Peter remembered and said, Rabbi, look, the fig tree you cursed has withered. Jesus answered them, have faith in God. Truly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be taken up and thrown into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will come to pass, it will be done for him. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you received it, it'll be yours. When you stand praying, forgive if you have anything against anyone, so that your Father who is in heaven might also forgive you. What did we just read? What in the world is going on? That was my first thought when I read this, because I know I have to preach it, was, oh no. What am I going to say? Did Jesus just throw a fit because he couldn't find a snack? Is that what just happened? Notice the way it interweaves. We start in the temple in verse 11. We go to the fig tree. We come back to the temple. We go back to the fig tree. And then he teaches his disciples what's going on. Let's look at that. Let's look at these one by one. We'll start with the temple. What does the temple show us about this? About the anger of Jesus and what pleases Jesus. And I think that what we can see overall is that Jesus is pleased. We please him when we cherish God. Because that was the problem they were having there in the temple. What's the temple supposed to be?
House of prayer.
House of prayer. That's right. He says it right there in the passage. My house is supposed to be a house of prayer for all the nations. And if you look at the bigger picture, this is actually a quote from the book of Isaiah. You don't have to turn there. I'll read it to you. It comes from Isaiah chapter 56, verse 7, if you want the reference, where he says, talking about these foreigners, right? But you remember that in those times, the Jews had been called out. There was a man named Abraham, and God picked him out of all the people of the whole world. He could have picked anybody. God picked Abraham. He says, I'm going to make you into a special kind of people, a chosen people. Abraham had a son, Isaac. Isaac had a son, Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons. Those were the 12 tribes of Israel. They just kept having more and more. This becomes the nation of Israel, God's chosen people. They got the idea, though, that because we're chosen by God, that's it. We're the only ones. Everybody else is just, well, they're goyim, not God's people. And God wanted to correct that right away. It didn't happen. It didn't start when Jesus came. It came into effect after the resurrection, but it was always the plan to include the Gentiles. And Isaiah is making this prediction. He says that these foreigners are going to come and they enjoin themselves to the Lord. In 56:7, these I will bring to my holy mountain. That's a big deal. You remember in those days, whenever they wanted to worship, they would find the high places. That's a big hill. Let's go plant a pole up there and worship our God there. That's closest to heaven. And God says, I'm inviting the foreigners to my holy hill. And I will make them joyful in my house of prayer. Why would a Gentile be joyful in the house of prayer? Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar. For my house shall be called a house of prayer for nations, for all peoples. This temple is supposed to be a place of a personal relationship with God. He says, I'm going to bring them up on my holy hill. I'm going to bring them to where I am because I want to be near them. I want to be their God, and I want them to be my people too. It's a place of personal relationship, and it's a place where you have this joy in God's house. How can you possibly have joy being too close to God? If you're forgiven, and you're accepted, and you're loved, how could you have anything else? That's the point he's making. He said, I'm inviting the Gentiles in to come and worship, and it's a house of prayer, a house of joy. And everything they bring, their offerings, their sacrifices, their worship will be pleasing to me. And so the temple is supposed to be a place of blessing. The temple is supposed to be a place of delight. Now, we don't have a temple like that. We're going to get to this part later, but we kind of are this temple, right? Is this a place of delight? Is this a place where you can come and just worship God today? My soul was fed as I sang and as I prayed and as I fellowshiped and as I heard the word. A place of delight, a place of pleasure. Place where we can come and cherish God. But what was going on in the story? Jesus said, you have turned it into a den of what?
Robbers.
You know the difference between robbery and burglary? If you're burgled, somebody broke into your house and stole your stuff. Burgled, that's a fun word, isn't it? Robbery is when someone comes right up to you and takes what you have. They have a gun, they stick it in your nose, and they say, give me your wallet. You just got robbed. And what Jesus is saying is that you have turned my house into a den of robbers. It's not just that you're taking stuff that doesn't belong to you. You are in broad daylight, accosting people, threatening people, taking their stuff. It was partly from what they were doing. They were ripping people off. See, the Romans had a coin. You remember there's another story where they say, hey, Jesus, should we pay taxes? And Jesus says, let me see the coin. And oh, whose picture is that? Oh, that's Caesar. Well, give unto Caesar what is Caesar's. That was the money that everybody used. But if you want to go into the temple and you need to offer a sacrifice, people came from all over the area there. They didn't bring all their sacrifices with them. Instead, they would travel to the temple. They had to by law. They would travel to the temple. they would buy an animal there and then sacrifice that animal to God. It worked out great because it was already pre-selected by the priests. It was a lamb without blemish. It was a bird without any kind of problems. This is approved. You can offer this to God. But what they were doing, they said, you can't buy the animals with the Roman coin. Instead, what you have to do is you have to take it over there to that table, and that guy is going to give you a temple coin in exchange for your Roman coin. Oh, okay. Well, I have a $1 Roman coin. How much can I get? Not $1 worth of shekel coin, no, or temple coin. No, you're going to get less. There was an exchange rate. They were making money off of people swapping out that coin. And then you want to go and you buy a pigeon, which was the cheapest one. That was the one for the poor people. You can't afford a lamb. Buy a pigeon. Offer that to God instead. Well, it's 15 cents out here, or you can pay a dollar for it right here. But we won't take the one out there because we'll find the blemish. And we're robbing people. People who are commanded to go and worship God, they're there. Many with the best interests at heart, and they're getting robbed in the process by the priests. So the worst part of this, it is that they were ripping people off, but the quote comes from Jeremiah. And in Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 9, we see that the problem is far worse than just stealing from people. It's the whole attitude behind it. Listen to the context of this passage. He says, "Will you steal and murder and commit adultery and swear falsely and worship false gods, and then come and stand before me in this house, which is called by my name, and say, 'We're delivered.'" You're going to do all that, and then you're going to come stand in front of me and say that, only to go on doing all these abominations. There's no change in your heart. There's no fear of me. There's no worship. You are using me. Has this house, which is called by my name, become a den of robbers for you? What is a den of robbers? It's not just a collection of them. It's a hiding place. We go out and we do whatever we want to do. We live however we want to live. And then we run back here on Sunday and, oh, I'm in church. I said the prayer. I did the stuff. I did the thing. And he says, that is not going to cut it. And so, he'll return the debts of the money changers. Get these coins out of them. And the people who were selling the pigeons, he did the same thing. And he wouldn't allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. All this merchandise. You have turned this place into nothing more than a store where people are robbed. I want it all out. The problem wasn't that they weren't in the right place. The problem isn't that they didn't spend enough time in church, or that they weren't reading enough, or praying enough. They had all that stuff down. The problem was that they were surrounded by the things of God, and they did not see Him in it. The problem was that they had everything that they needed right there, and they had no regard for Him. He was nothing more than a tradition to them, a task. There was plenty of observance of God, plenty of ritual, but no worship. And so as I studied that this week, I just wondered, you know, as a pastor, it speaks to me, because I get my livelihood from this. When I sit down to prepare a sermon, I am doing my job. Am I worshiping? Because if I'm not worshiping, how am I any different than them? When you come into this building and you're ready to spend time with God and the fellowship with other people, are you here making connections and just fulfilling yourself and getting part of the week? Or are you cherishing God? Jesus wants us to cherish Him like that. To find life and sustenance in Him. To find meaning and purpose and fulfillment and contentment. And to love Him more than anything else. If you take that out, all that you have left is a stone building full of people and animals. You take that out, what do we have? A Sunday group that meets every Sunday. That's it. We just meet here and talk about God. gather, there are very many people. Jesus says, where two or more gather, I'm right there with you. You can cherish me with just one other person. Now, that's the temple. Jesus wants us to cherish God. What about the tree? What's the tree? Show us. Well, the big picture is it shows us that Jesus is pleased with us when we do good works. When our lives are affected by the way we cherish God. If you cherish God, you're going to show it the way you live. That's what Jesus wants him to see here. Because it affects the way that you walk. The picture is he's looking for fruit. And the Bible uses fruit to talk about the way you live your life. So if I live my life always angry and I'm I'm contentious and I'm selfish and I'm greedy, well, it's going to show by the way I live, right? I'm not going to be nice to people. I'm going to be closed-handed and try to keep all my stuff. I'm going to hoard everything. But I'm going to pull the wealth, but my hands are open, I'm kind, I'm generous, all that kind of stuff. That's fruit. It seems pretty strange that Jesus would go up and curse this fig tree, especially since Mark goes to the point to show us exactly it wasn't even the time for fruit. So I read that. I'm like, well, why would he do that? That doesn't make sense. Why would he blame the tree? But the thing about it is, there are other passages. We're going to read a little bit of one. And there are other passages that talk about what they call the early figs. So you have this crop in the summer. Pick it up in the fall. The next year, in the springtime, there's a bonus crop of these early figs. They come with the leaves. They're not as good, but you can eat them. Jesus is hungry. If those early figs aren't on the tree with the leaves, it's a sign that you're not going to have a crop that summer. And so Jesus goes up to this tree, which should have some early figs, and it doesn't. So he curses it. But it's symbolic. It's not just a temper tantrum. Jesus never does anything like that. Instead, what Jesus is doing, he goes to the temple and he looks around and he says, no fruit. I'm going to curse it. He goes out with his disciples and he says, hey, you see this tree? It's cursed and it has no fruit. That's weird. They go back to the temple, though, and he begins to cleanse it. He's showing them that Israel and the temple are supposed to be fruit bearers. They're so close to God. How can you not be filled with the good things of God? There's another passage in the Old Testament where he's talking about Israel. He says, I went and I looked at them, and I saw no first figs that my soul desires. I looked at their lives, and I did not see fruit. And that makes me angry. None of the things that you expect to be there are there. That tree was promising fruit, and it gave none. Jesus said, I'm going to use that to symbolize the fruitlessness of the temple. You would walk in that place expecting to find forgiveness and joy and prayer, and instead all you hear is cha-ching, cha-ching, cha-ching. It's all for money and for gain. So he judged them. And maybe think of that passage where John predicted this. He says, look, folks, the axe is already at the root of the tree. And it's ready to chop down any tree that does not produce fruit. And Jesus said that the kingdom of God is going to be taken away from that first people and given to a people that produce the fruit of the kingdom. He's going to take it from the Jews and give it to the Gentiles. But if you cherish God, it affects your life. That's where it comes from. If you cherish him, it affects the way that you live. It gives you what the Bible calls the fruit of the Spirit. Love. If you cherish God, you're going to have love in your life. Because God is love. And when he is inside of your heart, when he fills you with good things, that love is going to overflow and pour out all over. cherish God and you worship Him, who can take your joy? Because you have everything that you need. If you have that, then you also have peace. And if you have that peace, then you've got patience. I can wait, God. I've got you. And you have goodness and faithfulness and self-control. And I love, this is from Galatians 5, where Paul is listing these fruits of the Spirit. And at the end of that, he says, against such things, there is no law. In other words, these are the things that please God. So I want to ask you this. How's your fruit? Do you worship God? Do you cherish Him? How's your worship? Does it affect the way you walk? Does it affect your life? Does it come from a relationship? Are you more like Jesus? This is what pleases Him. Now, lastly, the temple, the tree. I want to talk about what He taught His disciples. This to me is maybe the hardest part. I feel like if this part hadn't been on there, the rest of the passage would have been really easy to preach. But He throws this on. And I struggle. What does it mean? Why would He say this? It sounds that in Matthew it actually says that the disciples looked at the withered tree and they say, "How'd you do that?" Which is strange, because it's like, how did I raise the dead? So it's got to mean something a little different, right? Why are they so surprised? How'd you do that, Jesus? He says, you need to believe in God. Whoever tells this mountain to move itself somewhere else and believes, doesn't doubt, it'll be done. So whatever you ask in prayer, believe you received it in church. And whenever you stand praying, forgive. So that your Father in heaven may forgive you. Seems out of place, but a couple things that we need to think about. Let's notice this, okay? The temple is supposed to be a house of prayer, a place of forgiveness. It is what it was. Take the Isaiah verse, that's exactly what it was. It was a place for the nations to come and pray and for their offerings to be accepted. They can find forgiveness, they can worship. That's what the temple was supposed to be. It's a place where you can pour out your heart to God and you know that it's not in vain because God hears you and answers you. It's about to be taken away. He's been telling them. He's going to tell them in chapter 13, you see these stones, like, Jesus, look at this amazing building, look at these amazing stones. And He says, the time's coming when not one stone will be left on top of another. It's going to become exactly like that tree with its withered roots. It's about to be taken. But you have this within yourselves. You have this thing that the temple offers, the ability to worship God, to approach Him. You have this ability to bear good fruit and to change your life and to walk in a way that's pleasing to Him and consistent with the gospel. You have it within yourselves because Jesus is the chief cornerstone of the spiritual temple. And what are we? You are like living stones being built up as a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, and to offer spiritual sacrifices that are acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. What Jesus is saying here is that you have everything you need within yourself because of me. They are supposed to cherish God there, and it is supposed to show by the way they live. Obviously, that's not working. It's on its way out. But you have faith in God. You find this in me. Because I'm the cornerstone, I'm also the vine. I'm the vine. And you are the, what does it say? Branches. Yeah. Abide in me and you will bear much fruit. You have it within yourselves. So believe that you've received it and it's yours. You have power Because you have faith in God. It's not a passage at all about lust, which is where your mind goes if you just read it out of context. I mean, even just reading it in context, you're like, why is it talking about believe it and receive it? It's not about that. It's about belief in God. It's about belief in the power of God, that God is faithful to do what he said he would do, and that he can do it. And what can God do? God can move the biggest mountains. When we say, take this mountain, uproot yourself, and go over there, it's not my power. I can't do that. I can't pick up a pebble and do that. Not with my mind. You just pick yourself up and go. I can't do that. But God can. And it's a euphemism. I mean, we still use it. I mean, if that guy has faith, that can move mountains. Not literally. But he believes in God so firmly that if he knew that's what God wanted him to do, he would say it and wouldn't really be surprised that it happened. Because God wanted it. You have this within yourself. You have the power of God working you right now. Do you understand that? You as believers understand that? That he has given us all things pertaining to life and godliness. That we're partakers of his divine nature. The power of God is at work inside of us right now. So we can cherish him, and we can bear fruit. He says, just believe in God. Do you believe that? Where are you struggling right now to believe in God? Are you looking at a job you hate doing? And there's just no way out. Is there a relationship? Maybe your marriage, it just looks like it's headed for divorce, or it's just headed downward fast. These are mountains. How do you move those mountains? You got medical bills coming in so fast, it's just stacking up, and you just look at it and go, I don't even know how I'm going to pay this. You're struggling with a sin, and you just can't be. You struggle with even to be saved. I mean, I don't know if God can save me. Jesus is pleased when we cherish him and when our lives change because of it. His power is able to do that for us. Have faith in God. Ask him. Believe that he can do any of it. Stop and just cherish him for a minute. What? The beauty and the joy of the nearness of God fill your heart. Just believe his promises and say, God, help me with my unbelief. God, help me move this mountain. It says that last part, whenever you stand praying, forgive so that your Father in heaven may forgive you. You can bear that fruit because of him within you. It's the exact opposite of those money changers. They did not care about forgiveness. They cared about that money. And God says, look, I've forgiven you so much. I'm in you. Everything that the temple was supposed to bring, they failed. I complete in you. I want to close with the first song, because it seems to speak so clearly this concept. Blessed is the man who does not walk. Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the way of sinners, nor sit in the seat of mockers, but his delight. Anybody know what comes next? What's his delight in? And on his law he meditates day and night. He's like a tree. Like a tree. Planted by streams of water. His leaf does not wither. Whatever he does, prospers. What do what I want you to do with this message. What do I hope will happen? I preach this, you do what? I hope that you will delight yourself in the law of the Lord. I hope that you will cherish God with all your heart and that you will worship Him for who He is and for what He's done. So I want to do that. When I crack open the Bible, man, it's just so boring to me. You know why the Bible's boring to me? I was thinking about that this week as I was reading. You know why it's so boring to people sometimes? It's for the reason anything is boring. You don't see any value in it. You don't see the benefit. And it's hard to get into. There's a book I'm reading right now. I love this book. It's my third try to start reading. The first time, I got about a paragraph in, and I was like, and I put it away. It meant nothing to me. I picked it up about 6 months later. I got about halfway through the first chapter, and I said, it's pretty good, and I put it away. Then, the third time I came back, and I read enough of it that, I kind of interested in what's happening with the characters now. I see some value in reading this. I want to know what happens next. And so it's not boring to me to read anymore. I'm actually into it. Sometimes the Bible's that way to us. Is that we read and we say, oh, do, doth, thou, this, that, genealogy, that, and there's, okay, I don't care. But when your soul is thirsty, and you find sustenance, when you find water in the Word, that was my testimony when I was saved. The Lord has taken away your sin, you're not going to die. And I said, oh, that's what I need. And it became like water to me. The reason that you find no sustenance in the Word is because your soul is not thirsty or hungry. And you're not hungry or thirsty because you're not paying attention. We work so hard to improve our minds and our bodies. We have all these goals. We have all these things that we would like to do with life. And sometimes we completely neglect our soul. And what can you profit for your soul? What do you think those money changers profited? Jesus went through the temple, kicked over all the tables, he left. How long do you think it took him to have all the money gathered back up, the tables upright, and back in business? They had no care for their soul. I want you to delight in the law of the Lord. Just take 5 minutes and say, you know what? I might not find anything valuable today, but I'm just going to read for 5 minutes and see what God says. Maybe before you go in, say, God, you want me to cherish you? Show me why. Just start reading. Have faith in God. He can move that mountain. I want you to delight in Him. And after that, I want you to prosper. I want you to prosper in faith and in good works so that you can say, I know that God is with me. I have been so close to Him. I have seen His goodness. And it changes the way that I live. Look at this good fruit. Do you see the good fruit in your own life? I was this way before I was saved, and I was this way, totally different, right after. And it's just been a constant, steady stream of growth ever since. I want you to delight in the Lord. I want you to ask Him for fruit. And I want you to wait for Him. Because He's faithful and powerful. Jesus, thank you for your goodness. May we, through this, cherish you. And may we bear good fruit that brings you glory and fills us up. Amen.
I know on your sheet that has Jesus Messiah, but let's do the great I Am again. focus on him.